How has life managed to survive over 3 billion years on the Earth, and what adaptations does it need to survive environmental changes throughout its long tenure on the Earth? Well, one of the best ways to answer this question is to go and look at how life manages to survive and grow in extreme environments. Well, what do we mean by extreme? Some people think that it's a very anthropocentric term. It's just a matter of taste. What may be extreme to one organism is not extreme to another. But we think that there is something much more fundamental to it than that. Biological systems do only function in a continuum of particular physical and chemical extremes. And as we go to these so-called extremes, such as high temperature, low temperature, increased pressure, we find that the diversity of life generally in these environments tends to decrease. So it does seem that there are real extremes, extremes beyond which life cannot go, boundaries to the biosphere that are determined by physical and chemical extremities. And studying the organisms at these extremities can tell us much about how life on Earth has managed to cope with conditions on our planet, and just as interestingly, whether life might be able to cope with the physical and chemical extremes to be found on other planetary bodies. The organisms that inhabit these extreme environments we call extremophiles, literally extreme lovers. They're mainly the prokaryotes, the bacteria and archaea that we saw in the Tree of Life, but there are some eukaryotes that live in extreme environments, even flies, for example, that live at the edges of volcanic hot springs in Yellowstone National Park. But by and large, once we get to really great extremes on the Earth, we find that the organisms that are inhabiting these environments are the prokaryotes. What are the types of extreme environments that exist out there? Well, these are some of the environments that we'll look at in a little more detail. There are hot and cold places. There are places that are very salty or very dry. There are also places that are very acidic or very alkaline or basic. And there are also places with intense pressure and also intense radiation. Let's have a look to begin with at hot environments. There are many hot environments on the Earth that harbour life. A good example is deep sea hydrothermal vents, places where reduced fluids containing sulfides and other types of chemicals are spewing out from the crust of the Earth into the oceans. And these hydrothermal vents can be producing water well over 100 degrees centigrade because of the high pressure in the deep oceans. The organisms that inhabit these hot environments, which also include volcanic hot springs in places like Yellowstone National Park, are called thermophiles if they grow between 50 and 80 degrees, or if they grow at really high temperatures above 80 degrees, they're called hyperthermophiles. Now, it's important to remember that these organisms aren't just capable of growing at these temperatures, they actually need to grow at high temperatures. If you take a hyperthermophile, for example, whose optimum growth temperature is above 80 degrees, and you bring it down to room temperature, it will generally die. These are microbes that actually have to be growing at these very high temperatures. A good example is Methanopyrus candleri. This is an archaea that inhabits black smokers, deep ocean hydrothermal vents that are black because they're producing sulfide minerals that are produced in the oceans as these fluids gush out of these black smoker vents. The organism can grow up to temperatures of 110 degrees centigrade. Some of the challenges it faces, like all thermophiles or hyperthermophiles, are the breakdown of biomolecules. Those high temperatures impart energies to the microorganisms that tend to cause the biomolecules to break down. They also have a problem with membrane fluidity. Very high temperatures, the energy causes the membranes to start shaking apart, almost quite literally, and that fluidity in the membrane can cause problems for the integrity of the cell membrane. How does it deal with these challenges with living in these high temperature environments? Well, two of the ways it deals with this is by evolving thermostable proteins and enzymes, enzymes being biological catalysts involved in carrying out chemical reactions in the cell. These proteins have extra chemical bonds and other types of features that maintain their stability at these very high temperatures. It turns out that these proteins or catalysts, these enzymes, have commercial uses as well. For example, thermostable catalyst enzymes are used in biological washing powder. One of the reasons why your washing powder can work at high temperatures is because it contains proteins or enzymes from microorganisms that have been isolated from hydrothermal springs, volcanic hot springs. So you see, we can use these thermostable enzymes and proteins for some very prosaic but commercially useful applications. Other adaptations include changes to the cell membranes and composition to allow those membranes to maintain stability at high temperatures. Microorganisms have also been found in freezing environments, such as the depths of Antarctic ice sheets. This is an example of a deep lake in the Antarctic ice sheet called Vostok. And just above that lake are microorganisms in the ice, in the accretion ice that forms above that deeply buried lake. In these sorts of ice sheets, microorganisms adapted to cold conditions can grow, and these are called psychrophiles, microorganisms that can grow at temperatures of less than 15 degrees centigrade. What are the challenges of living in a cold environment? Well, one challenge, of course, is membrane damage from ice. If ice crystals form in the cell, it can damage the membranes. Another problem is decreased membrane fluidity. Under very cold temperatures, the lipids literally begin to solidify, a bit like if you put butter in your fridge. It begins to go a lot more solid. Those fatty acids, those lipids in the cell membranes, begin to solidify at very cold temperatures and reduce the fluidity of the membrane that's necessary for the cell to export materials and import nutrients. Another obvious problem in freezing environments is the availability of liquid water. Much of it is frozen up in ice, and so organisms can have trouble getting hold of the liquid water that they need to carry out biochemical reactions. So how is it that these microbes can adapt to these extremely cold conditions? Well, one way in which they adapt is by altering their membrane composition. A bit like the microbes living at high temperatures, they need to change the composition of the membranes to maintain their fluidity at low temperatures. One way in which they can do this is to incorporate more unsaturated fatty acids into their membranes. These unsaturated fatty acids have kinks in the membrane structure that pushes apart the membrane and makes it more fluid under cold conditions. Some of these microbes and other organisms also have antifreeze agents, such as sugars, and these sugars prevent ice crystals from forming in the cells and reduce the chances of ice crystals forming and damaging the membranes, another way in which they can circumvent the problems of growing at very low temperatures. So that's hot and cold environments. What about salty and dry environments? Well, microorganisms have been found that can inhabit very salty environments, such as microbes that live in the Dead Sea and in deposits of salt around the Dead Sea. These are called halophiles, and these halophiles, literally salt lovers, can grow at salt concentrations between 15 and 37%. Microbes that live in deserts are also capable of tolerating very dry conditions, and these are called xerophilic microbes. You can find them in the deserts of the Atacama, the Sahara, and other dry and desiccated environments of the Earth. The challenges of living in salty and dry conditions are actually quite similar. One problem is osmotic pressure and water availability. In very high salt concentrations, the salt has the tendency to pull water out of the cells by the process of osmosis. So cells have a problem in hanging on to their liquid water. And of course, in dry deserts, the problem is also the water tends to evaporate, which causes problems for the maintenance of water in the cell, but also osmotic effects in very dry conditions. Another challenge faced by microbes in both salty and dry environments is membrane integrity, maintaining the integrity of the membranes and preventing them from falling apart under these very high salt concentrations that tend to disrupt biomolecules, and under very dry conditions where the dry conditions also tend to cause disruption to the membranes, lack of water. How do organisms adapt to these very extreme salty and dry conditions? Well, two ways they can adapt are to control water loss from the cells. They can produce salts and other solutes within the cell that tend to hang on to the water, make it more difficult for it to dissipate from the cell. Another way in which they can deal with these extreme conditions is to go into a state of dormancy. When they're dormant, they're not active, but it allows them to wait around until conditions improve. This is particularly the case for microbes living in deserts, where they may want to go dormant and wait until liquid water becomes available, and they can reproduce and grow again, and then go into a state of dormancy when it dries up. Microbes have also been found that live at extremes of pH. For example, the Rio Tinto River in Spain has pHs down to 0.4, a high concentration of protons in the water makes it very, very acidic. There are also places with very high pH, such as Mono Lake in the United States, that has a pH up to 12.5, very alkaline or basic environments that pose great challenges to microbes. The challenges that are faced to the organisms that live in these environments include the breakdown of their cellular components. For example, in acidic environments, the very high proton concentration that's responsible for that acidity can disrupt biomolecules, causing them to become inoperative. These very challenging pH conditions are also a great challenge to metabolic processes, processes for gaining energy and carrying out chemical reactions inside the cell. How do cells adapt to these extreme pHs? Well, one way in which they can adapt is to regulate the pH inside the cell in order to make it neutral. So, for example, a microorganism living in very acidic environments will pump out protons from the cell and maintain the inside of the cell at near neutral pH. And at neutral pH, the biomolecules are much more stable and metabolic processes can proceed without disruption. In other words, these cells really don't like to be in an acidic environment, but they can change their internal conditions such that they can survive and grow in acidic environments without the acid on the outside of the cell affecting cellular reactions inside the cell. This is a really ingenious way by which cells can survive and grow in acidic conditions. And similar sorts of processes are also found in very alkaline environments. Organisms have also adapted to life under high pressure. In fact, many of the habitats on the Earth for life are actually at high pressure. Two examples are the deep oceans and the deep crust of the Earth. In the deep oceans, many of the trenches are at great depths, such as the Mariana Trench at 11 kilometers depth, and here pressures exceed 1,000 atmospheres. The microbes that can live in these environments are called piezophilic microbes, literally pressure-loving microbes. In fact, at the current time, we don't know what the upper pressure limit for life is, but certainly they can survive at the high pressures to be found in these deep ocean trenches. Microbes are also found in the deep crust, living in rocks, kilometers underneath the surface of the Earth. The challenges of living at high pressure are the pressures cause the tight packing of molecules and the loss of fluidity in cell membranes. Pressure can also cause impaired cellular functions and activities, particularly of enzymes that are necessary to carry out the catalytic functions of chemical reactions inside the cell. How do organisms adapt to live at these high pressure environments in the deep oceans or in the crust? Well, one way in which they can adapt is by changing gene expression. They can produce, for example, molecules that enhance the uptake of nutrients and other elements that they need for growth across the cell membrane and thereby adapt to these challenging environments under high pressure. They can also change their membrane structure, for example, by introducing unsaturated fatty acids to increase membrane fluidity under high pressures. And you'll notice that unsaturated fatty acids were also the way in which microbes can adapt to low temperatures. So some of the mechanisms that organisms use to adapt to one extreme are also used to adapt to other extremes. There can be common responses to different environmental extremes. We might think about one of the most extreme environments known to man, and that is the conditions of outer space. Can microorganisms survive in outer space? Space is characterized by extremes of radiation, freezing temperatures, desiccation, and no oxygen. A few years ago, my own laboratory launched rocks into Earth orbit, and these rocks were bolted onto the outside of the International Space Station, and we brought them back to Earth a year and a half later to see whether anything had survived in space. And we found a single microorganism, a Aglaia capsa, which is a type of cyanobacterium, a photosynthetic microorganism that was capable of surviving in the extreme conditions of space for a full year and a half. Of course, it didn't grow in space, but it did survive. These types of experiments show how outer space is an environment that can even be survived by some microorganisms, showing how hardy they are and how able they are to resist environmental extremes, if only for a short length of time. Many extremes that we find on the Earth don't occur in isolation. I've talked about high and low temperatures. I've talked about salty environments and highly acidic and alkaline environments, but in fact, in many natural environments, there are frequently multiple extremes. And astrobiologists are very interested in polyextremophiles, extremophiles that can tolerate multiple extremes. Here's just one example, a rather famous organism called Deinococcus radiodurans. This is a microbe that can tolerate high levels of radiation. It's also found in environments with cold temperatures. It's found in deserts that are very dry. Some of these organisms can tolerate vacuum conditions, and members of this group, the Deinococci, are also found in very acidic environments as well. So we see how there are polyextremophiles that can survive multiple extremes, and by studying these microorganisms, we can get better understandings of how microbes tolerate the boundaries of extremes that define the boundaries of the Earth's biosphere. Why is this of any interest to astrobiologists? Well, there are really two reasons why we're interested in studying microbes at extremes, and particularly those microbes that can tolerate multiple extremes. First of all, of course, it tells us about the boundaries of the Earth's biosphere. What are the limits of life on Earth? When do we go beyond those limits? And how might environmental changes throughout the history of the Earth, even environmental changes caused by humans, affect life on Earth and those microorganisms that inhabit the outer boundaries of the biosphere? But the other reason for being interested in studying life in extreme environments is because it might give us better ideas about the habitability of other worlds, such as Mars, Europa, Enceladus and Titan, and other planetary bodies of interest to astrobiologists. Once we know the physical conditions on those planetary bodies, we want to be able to assess whether they are within the boundaries for life, whether life might be able to persist on those planetary bodies. The only way in which we can do that is by studying microorganisms and life in general in extreme environments and seeing whether the extremes that we observe on other planetary bodies are extremes that can be tolerated by life forms that we know on the Earth. So the study of life in extreme environments is essential for assessing habitability, the ability of other planetary bodies to harbour life. So what have we learned in this lecture? We've learned that extremophiles are organisms that tolerate or require physical and chemical extremes in order to be able to survive or grow and reproduce. We've learned that although extremophiles span all major domains of life, most of them come from the prokaryotes, bacteria and archaea. We've learned that adaptations to extreme conditions sustain cell integrity and function, frequently via modifications to the cell membrane and molecules such as proteins and enzymes, catalytic molecules in cells. We've learned that interactions between multiple extremes may influence extremophile growth and survival. The study of life in extreme environments is pivotal to understanding the emergence of life on the Earth and understanding the boundaries for life in the universe at large. And finally, we've also learned that molecules isolated from extremophiles may also have commercial and industrial use.